Thank you. Mr. President, entrepreneurs, today is 14 juillet, and Belgium is exactly 14 days in its presidency of the European Council. And if I may say, we're on track. We're on track because debate regarding the new financial architecture is at full speed, as you know, as you can read in the newspapers. And I myself, in my function as the head of the Council Competitiveness, I was in Strasbourg last week for a hearing. I was on Monday in Brussels for a hearing in the European Parliament. And to be honest, this is the first sector event that we've been organizing with the FOD Economy, with the Administration of Economy, during this presidency under my function. And it's dedicated to the chemical sector and the chemical industry, Mr. President, because this is, like you've been saying, a very important sector. I want to welcome you to this unique event today here on the premises of BASF. This is not the first time I'm here. I was here at the midst of the very crisis, and I was amazed by the way this company, BASF, as many other companies in Belgium, coped with the effects of the crisis. And today it's good to see that already some economic growth is coming back again, and hopefully we can be more positive on that. And it's true, Mr. President, that we are at the heart of the world's second largest chemical cluster in the world. So that is important. The conference today will allow us to discuss the importance of the chemical industry and the chemical sector, not only for Belgium, but also for Europe as a whole. And during my tenure as a Minister of Economy for Belgium, I have had the chance to work very closely with the chemical sector, and I'm glad that I can now use the results of this work to steer European policy during our presidency. It is true that the European chemical industry is key for economic growth and sustainable development in Europe. Some 29,000 chemical companies employ more than 1 million people and realize a turnover of more than half a trillion euro in Europe. And it is clear that the chemical industry is one of the biggest industrial sectors and an important source of direct and indirect employment. But contrary to the public perception, small and medium-sized enterprises represent a significant share of the EU chemicals industry. 96% of all chemical companies have fewer than 250 employees, and these are responsible for 28% of all sales and 35% of all total employment. And during my function as a minister, I had the chance to visit some of those companies thanks to the help of Essentia and its dedicated CEO, Yves Verschuren. The production of chemicals is largely concentrated in a few areas, notably Northwestern Europe. Germany, as you know, is the largest producer in Europe, followed by France, Italy, and the UK. And these countries, together with the Netherlands, Spain, Belgium, and Ireland, represent 88% of European turnover. Traditionally, Europe has been dominant in chemicals production, a position marked by an important export surplus, which has weakened in the past few years. It is true, things are changing. China and India have made successful efforts to build up large and increasingly sophisticated production facilities. And countries in the Middle East, notably due to their feedstock advantages, attract very high investments in petrochemicals. Consequently, the EU's share of global chemicals production is decreasing in several segments. Just to give you one example, between 1995 and 2005, world chemical production increased by almost 40%. However, over 95% of that growth was concentrated in developing countries. Therefore, we cannot deny the fact that Europe's competitive position is at risk. And therefore, the European Commission started a European high-level group in September 2007 that completed its report in February 2009. The goal of this group was to have a clear picture of the key drivers for the medium and long-term development of the complex and vastly diversified chemicals industry. Its conclusions are broad guidelines for the development and implementation of economic support measures at European and national level. Competitive Council of May 2009 invited the European Commission, the Member States and the industry to implement the conclusions of the high-level group and to consider these recommendations as a roadmap for concrete and deliverable activities. Commission was asked to proactively follow this up and to closely monitor the competitiveness of the industry as well as the progress made in the implementation of the above-mentioned conclusions. And the Council asked the Commission to present the first report evaluating the results by the end of 2010 in close consultation with the stakeholders. This report will thus be presented during the Belgian presidency, and this is one of the main reasons why we organize this conference here today. As a Belgian Minister for Economy, like Mr. De Geest, the President referred to, I also took the initiative together with him to launch a Belgian high-level group to address the issue of the competitiveness of the Belgian chemical industry. And normally, as you know, high-level groups, they talk a lot, and what you read are some aspects, abstract things, but during my job as a minister, I must say that the things I've learned from that high-level group in Belgium were pretty amazing, because the method that we used to compare our competitiveness, the Belgian competitiveness, with neighboring countries like Holland, like Germany, like France, learned a lot of things to us. We launched the group, we were pretty fast. We launched it in October 2009, and we completed our work just a few weeks ago. And out of that came, in fact, 15 recommendations to the new federal government, and we concentrated ourselves, we focused on five issues: on the labor market, the competitiveness or the lack of competitiveness when it comes to labor costs in Belgium, comparing with Germany, with Holland and with France. Innovation, what can we do with innovation? Logistics, energy, the cost of energy, and taxation. And like I've said, the 15 specific reform proposals that were derived from that will be presented to the new federal government. They are tough challenges, but very interesting, because, I mean, they will be important if Belgium wants to stay or become again a competitive country for the chemical sector. And I think that the same goes for Europe. What Europe should do is, if we want to compete as Europe with world players like the Middle East and the United States of America, peer reviewing can also be a sound method, because as the President has referred to, what is happening in the Middle East is quite remarkable. I had the chance with our Crown Prince, Prince Philippe, to visit a few countries there, and in the petrochemical sector, what is happening there is remarkable. At the same time, of course, we should be stay awake and try to do something about it. So that is one challenge. The second challenge, ladies and gentlemen, is to convince our people that the chemical industry is indeed, as it was said, at the roots of a more sustainable economy. On my way to here, I Twittered a message that, you know, Twitter is a, you know Twitter? Are you aware of Twitter? Yeah, some of them, okay. But you're not on Twitter yet, huh? Are some people on Twitter? Raise your hands. Mr. De Buck, yes, some are, yes. Very good. Well, I just mentioned it was one of the most interesting studies I got to know the last few years by my McKinsey on the CO2 emission status compared with what in the products launched by the chemical sector, what it was the positive effect. So each ton of CO2 that is produced by this sector is compensated by 2.6 ton in CO2 reduction by the products it makes. And that is what it shows, and that is the real proof of the fact that this sector is at the roots of a sustainable economy. And it's true, I can cite many examples. I'm sorry to just give you two examples. Derby Gum in Belgium has developed a highly reflective membrane to be put on rooftops. It acts as a passive color that reduces energy consumption by reflecting up to 80% of the sun rays. And with the tropical temperatures that we are experiencing now, this appears to be an innovation that is guaranteed commercial success. And secondly, the Solar Impulse project, a plane that flies on solar energy without burning any fossil fuel. Solar Impulse craft completed a 26-hour flight last week, was in the press, and is now gearing up for a trip to circumnavigate around the globe. The technology for this impressive feat was developed by Solvay here in Belgium. Well, these examples show that the European chemicals industry is well placed to provide sustainable solutions. And this is one area where European industry has some initial competitive advantage. There appears to be considerable market potential and a positive consumer attitude. Grasping this opportunity requires a positive, a proactive, and committed stance from the industry and from politicians and public authorities at all levels. And in Belgium, we have put in place a program to create an attractive climate for innovation. By reducing administrative barriers for the industry and by lowering the tax and social security charges for researchers. However, innovation is not the exclusive domain for the white aprons, for the scientists. It should be the focus of all employees. That is why we have introduced what we call the innovation bonus that allows employers to give their employees a tax-free reward of up to 1 month of salary for an innovative idea or concept. And on the European level, the EU patent is indeed the highest priority. We have a unique opportunity, ladies and gentlemen. Commissioner Barnier has put forward a good proposal, fundamentally reducing the translation costs. And globally, this sector files around 22,000 patents annually. This represents about 15% of the total number lodged at each major patent office in Europe, Japan, and the US. Due to the fragmented system of national patent rights in the EU, protection of intellectual property is more costly than in the US, Japan, or China. Indeed, obtaining a patent is 6 times more expensive in Europe than in the US, largely due to the translation and legal fees. The absence of a cheap and simple EU patent de facto constitutes a tax on innovation. And the proposal of Commissioner Barnier, in fact, implies that the translation cost will go down from 12,000 euros for a patent to 700 euros for a patent, which will be, of course, a true breakthrough. And it is the goal of the Belgian presidency and of myself. At the Commission, at the Parliament last week, I said that 80% of my energy will go to the EU patent. And when Mr. Barroso heard that, he said, only 80%. I said, no, of all the time I have, 80% is on the patent and the rest is for the other issue. But I really think, like I've talked to Mr. De Buck and other important players, that we have a true opportunity now to do so, because the Commission is fully behind it with Mr. Barroso, with Mr. Barnier. Next week, I will go to my colleague in London, Tuesday, Vince Cable. I will see my colleagues of Germany and France to try to build up a momentum. And then I would ask you, people from Solvay, from BASF, many people here from the industry, also to put your shoulders under that proposal, because if there is pressure from the industry at this moment, it will help me to convince my colleagues in other countries to break this decades-long stalemate on the EU patents. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think it is all about competitiveness and about growth. These are the two main issues for this industry. And that is what today's debates, speeches, and panels will be about. Learn from it, and I'm looking forward to a very interesting day here at BASF in Antwerp. Thank you very much.